I'm here at the UT Plant Pest Center, and it's a diagnostic lab for Nashville, Tennessee and the state. And we're going to be discussing issues with boxwood shrubs, which are the most common type, old type shrub that you will find in many large estates. And they're very popular shrub in new landscape plantings. But the problem with being popular with a boxwood shrub is that there are serious disease and insect issues that are creeping up. And one in particular we're going to look at today and do some serious discussion on with Dr. Alan Windham is called boxwood blight. So Alan Windham, it's good to see you again. And
good
we
to see
have
you, David.
Worked many years in the past. And I'm going to tell you, Alan is my mentor. That's what I got to call him. He's a mentor, a good friend. So Alan, as an extension agent, you do too. You get a lot of calls on various plants that have problems. And a lot of people refer to any issue, decline of a plant, as a blight. But you've actually have found a serious problem with a boxwood dud. The disease is called a blight, isn't it?
Right. There's a relatively new disease, boxwood blight, new to the U.S. in 2011, and first found in Tennessee in 2014. It's not really widespread, but we do find it every year. As a matter of fact, I've already diagnosed it in a Nashville garden since January. The first residential garden we found it in was in Knoxville, and I think the homeowner lost 600 boxwoods from it. So we've learned a lot about it since that time. So actually there is some good news. Number one, it hasn't spread as fast as we thought it might, which is good. And two, there are some treatments for it. And three, there's some regulatory things that are going on to help protect consumers when they buy boxwood so that the boxwoods they're buying are healthy.
Okay, when you said spread, maybe not spreading as rapidly, we know that fungal pathogens can be spread by spores and they could be airborne. So if this is not spreading, or if you see an isolated case, how did that disease occur? How did it get started on that one particular shrub if you don't see any other infections around it?
Long distance movement is via moving infected plant material. And short distance spread could be someone working in one garden, going to the next garden, and it's got really sticky spores. It could be on your clothing, your hands, tools. So one thing you need to do if you do shearing, pruning on boxwoods, probably disinfecting the tools would be a good thing, especially if you have more than one client and you go to another garden. Those tools need to be disinfected.
What would a homeowner look for, and what should they look for? And we encourage people to look for this problem, this boxwood blight, if they have boxwoods, because you want to be proactive. By the time you see the disease, you're in a lot of trouble. So what would be some symptoms, say, they could find on their boxwood shrub?
Okay, so during the growing season, you're going to see leaf spots, pretty good-sized leaf spots on the leaves, which is unique to this disease. And during the winter months, those leaves fall off, so the plant looks a little bare. But they're little black lesions on the green twigs, and there's no other disease that does that. So actually, it's really easy to diagnose.
Now, I've heard there's a quarantine, and where did that come from, and who enforces that?
So that was instituted by the Tennessee Department of Agriculture as a way to minimize the chance of infected boxwoods coming in from the state, because there's a lot of plant material shipped into the state each year. So basically, it's three things. Number one is that if a nursery is going to ship boxwoods into the state of Tennessee, they're going to be part of a boxwood blight cleanliness program to make sure they're doing everything they can to minimize chance of that disease being a problem. Two, they're going to be recently inspected before they ship. And three, the person, the vendor receiving the plants, has to notify the Department of Ag when they're going to arrive to give them a chance to inspect them.
Okay, so a quarantine is good and it's necessary, but it's not 100% foolproof, is it?
It's not.
So you have found several landscapes, and did you get a call from the person that was helping maintain that, or did you get a call from the owner?
Usually it's the person, the grounds manager, that maintains the property that we deal with. And I would say, so you know, when you manage diseases, first thing, be able to recognize it, which we mentioned, the leaf spots, the little lesions on the twigs. The second thing, bring a sample to the Soil, Plant, and Pest Center and have it identified. It's an easy thing for us to identify. We can usually do it within 24 hours of no problem. And then three, you decide whether you want to try to treat it, to remediate it on a plant because there's been a good bit of luck in doing that with some of the landscapes here in Nashville. You can spray with fungicides after you prune it back, remove the diseased portions, spray what's healthy, and you would do that probably every 2 weeks in the spring and fall with a fungicide, and maybe once a month in the summer. And then, once you no longer see any symptoms appearing, basically you just scout for symptoms for the near future, make sure that it doesn't come back.
Now, if someone brought this to me, and someone actually has brought this to you, and a lot of homeowners might think, is this boxwood blight? But I see the leaves are still attached on this.
Right, that's volutella blight, okay, which is very common, not very serious. May make the plant look a little thin, but then this is the one that you have the pink spore masses on the underside of the leaves, so it's really easy to identify.
Okay, is that visible with the naked eye?
It is.
But a hand lens, a little magnification would be helpful, too.
Hand lens would help.
Okay.
But it's easy for most lay people to identify.
Yeah. And I can see how it makes a plant look unsightly, but this is not going to kill the shrub or defoliate it.
No. Sometimes we'll see Vitella blight in conjunction with boxwood leaf miner. So boxwood leaf miner itself can make a boxwood look really rough and thin canopy and leaves that drop.
Yeah. So the boxwood leaf miner actually is just a little tiny gnat-like fly. And most people will never see that one flying around after they emerge, but they live inside the leaf. So they do a lot of damage. You kind of eat the leaf from the inside out. And you probably have some examples here. I know you've got some shrubber here that if you hold this up, it's amazing. If someone looked at this, they would think, well, it looks green, it looks healthy, and then they'll walk away thinking this shrub doesn't have a problem. But it has initial leaves that are infected. I get this blistering. This is actually kind of severe on right here.
It is. It is severe. And so you're right that most of the year this insect lives within the boxwood leaf. And what's interesting is that it emerges the same time boxwood's putting out new growth in the spring.
Okay.
So that's actually a good time to look. And if you go and look at your boxwood and you see new growth for the first time, you'll see these little gnat-like flies hovering all over the boxwood, and they're there to actually lay eggs.
Okay, Alan, let's get back on boxwood blight.
In the last couple of years, there have been some new boxwood cultivars released that are more tolerant of boxwood blight.
Okay, you're not using the word resistant yet. They get the disease. Now, resistance doesn't mean never. A plant can hold its own for a while, tolerate the disease, but most boxwoods are susceptible, though?
Most are. The ones that I have seen are. Actually, the little dwarf boxwoods are some of the ones that are most susceptible to it. The good news is that immune is probably the word you were looking for. We don't have any plants that are immune to it. Even the ones that are resistant may get the disease, but they'll probably retain their leaves and be able to just tolerate it very well.
A homeowner can find something at a garden center, a box store?
They can. Actually, most of the fungicides that are labeled for leaf spots would work pretty well. Now, as far as organic products, like a copper fungicide, don't know how well that would work. You definitely could try it, but you'd probably have to spray more often, maybe once a week, if you wanted to try an organic option. But other fungicides that are on market for leaf spots would probably work pretty well. The main thing is you can't just spray it and walk away from it and forget it. You have to go out and scout, see if you're seeing new growth. If the fungicide's working, you're going to see new growth. You're going to see new leaves developing, and you're going to see fewer of the leaves that have the leaf spots and less leaf drop. That tells you you're on the right track.
So this disease is going to be with us, right, for a long time?
Probably it will be with us for a long time.
Okay.
I don't think there's going to be a cure, but there's definitely things that we can do to minimize the damage from it. And I think the good news is more people know what it looks like. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, most cases that I've been involved in the past year, they recognized it really early so it didn't spread, which is like a best case scenario.
Okay, very good. So commercial people out there, they're getting educated on this. And we hope to educate homeowners through this taping of this show, too.
Sure.
So doesn't mean you shouldn't ever plant a boxwood. you should be aware that there are issues, some serious and some not so serious. So keep an open mind, but keep an open eye and scout and check your plants and keep them healthy.
Sure. They're great plants. They're the backbone for a lot of gardens in Tennessee, and I think they're going to be here for a long time.
Good deal. Well, thank you for your input. It's always best to go to the specialist.
Thank you, David.
Who knows what he's talking about, because I can ask the questions, I get good answers. Thank you, Alan.
Yeah, good to visit with you.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel and like us on Facebook.